As human beings, we can't help but be interested in our own self-preservation. We can't help but be self-interested. It's one of the strongest urges we have. Interested in our preservation. Interested in our development. Interested in our success. Certainly, there's nothing wrong with self-interest. But self-interest must be enlightened as to what truly serves us best. When I found out that self-interest was okay, that was a big relief to me. Now, we're not talking about selfishness, we're talking about self-interest. Self-interest needs to be educated. Enlightened self-interest is willing to benefit by serving others, not at the expense of others. Self-interest at the expense of others starts to be greed, evil. Hoping you go up as someone goes down. Hoping to obtain while someone else loses. I win, you lose. We call that the beginnings of evil, the dark side of our nature. Wishing to benefit at the expense of others. Enlightened self-interest wishes to benefit at the service of others. A friend of mine tells this little story about a person she hears from about every 3 months or so. This guy calls to solicit money for food baskets for homeless families. She's happy to give her money to them. She was, unfortunately, homeless for a short period of time, and she knows the position these people are in. This group is legit, she checked them out. But after the second or third time this guy called, the same guy, after the second or third time, she started talking to him about other stuff. Turns out, this guy is broke, living in a hotel, looking for any construction job he can find, any job at all. But what's unique about this guy is that he donates 2 or 3 hours a night to call people and get money to feed the homeless. Every night, from his hotel room. Now, most people would say this guy should use those hours every night to work a second job or a third job. But while he's way down on the ladder of success, he feels it's important to help those less fortunate than he is. He has a roof over his head, he makes enough to feed himself. And my friend says that every time she talks to this guy, every 2 or 3 months, he's doing better. He's digging himself out of debt. He's starting to save money. He thinks he'll be able to move into an apartment in another month or two. Now, recently, an interesting thing happened. My friend was talking with an associate of hers. She's single, lives in a big house. Needs to find a handyman to help her out on a regular basis. Someone who can build an addition onto her house. So my friend told her about this guy. The only reason this guy ended up being hired was that my friend's associate was touched by his dedication to service while he himself was down and out. Service, success at the service of others. Now, this guy isn't rich by any stretch, but through my friend's network, he now has constant work doing things around several people's houses. And now he's in a place of his own. And guess what he does every night? He's still making phone calls to get money to feed the homeless. What great character this man has. Enlightened self-interest leads to wealth. Self-preservation leads to poverty. Somebody says, well, I can't be concerned about other people. I have to pay attention to myself. Well, then you'll always have to. Somebody says, I can't be concerned about other people's bills. I've got enough worries trying to pay my own. Well, then you'll have to worry about them for the rest of your life. The best way to get that monkey off your back is to turn your attention around. Once I understood some of this stuff I'm telling you, it revolutionized my whole life. Now, self-interest is okay. Yes, but here's what self-interest must be if you truly want to be happy. It must be enlightened. It says, don't keep your attention on yourself if you want your life to work out well. Turn your attention to others in your own self-interest. Be enlightened. Truly act in your own self-interest by making an investment in service to others. Next, if you wish to receive, now there's nothing wrong with wishing to receive, it's part of self-interest. But here's the enlightened part. If you wish to receive, you must give. Some people say if you give, it's gone. No, not if you're educated. If you're stupid, yes, it's gone. But if you're enlightened, chances are, if you give, you've invested. And what do we expect an investment to do? Return, earn, get back what you put out. No, we expect it to return multiplied, bigger, greater, better. My father taught me way back, son, always do more than what you get paid for. Now, some individuals might argue with that. They'd say, no, you're going to mess up the whole program. I know they're wrong. In my own self-interest, I did what my father taught me. To always do more than I got paid for. Why? To make an investment in my future. Do more than you get paid for to make an investment in your future. And it's paid off for me. If you're wanting that big promotion, are you going to go up to your boss and say, just give it to me. I'll work harder if you just give me that promotion. No, it doesn't work that way. You've got to do more in your current position so that you get noticed, so you stand out from everybody else. So the boss says, hey, we've got this position opening up, and I think we should give it to Nancy. She does so much more than we expect. Just imagine what she'll do if we give her this promotion. You've got to do more than you're paid for. You've got to. It's an investment in your future. It's one thing to make a sale. I'm telling you, if you make a sale, you'll make a living. If you go beyond making the sale and serve people by keeping in touch, calling them before they call you, writing a thank you note, sales will lead to multiple sales. You can make a fortune. If the customer is well taken care of, people who are well taken care of will open doors you can't get through by yourself. All of us have found ways to make a living. What got interesting for me early on was to figure out ways to make a fortune. You'd say, well, Mr. Rohn, how would I deserve to make a fortune? It's easy. Render fortunes of service. People will do things you cannot believe for people who give them good service. Here's one of the greatest gifts you can give anybody, the gift of attention. In return, they will do extraordinary things for your career, take you by the hand, and lead you to more people than you could meet by yourself. Always do more than you get paid for. Bonds to deserve, not need. Life was not designed to give us what we need. Life was designed to give us what we deserve. Once you understand that little life principle in your own self. Interest, I'm telling you, it's life-changing. The ancient law does not go like this. If you need, you will reap. No, it doesn't work that way. A lot of people out there are hoping it works that way, but no, it doesn't. The ancient law goes like this. If you plant, you will reap. If you sow, you will reap. Somebody says, well, I really need to reap. Well, then you really need to plant. It's in your own self-interest. Your own self-interest needs to be educated in how to plant, how to do it so everybody wins. Because life doesn't respond to need. You can't go to the soil and say, I need a crop. The soil just smiles at you. And here's what the soil says. Don't bring me your need, bring me some seed. Bring me some effort, bring me some discipline, bring me some interest, bring me some service. Bring me these things, and I'll return to you multiplied. 2 times, 5 times, 10 times. You can't come with need. You've got to come with seed. You've got to come with willingness. You've got to come with skills. You've got to be willing to learn, willing to change, willing to grow, willing to put yourself out, willing to stand up to the bad weather, willing to pull out the weeds, willing to nurture. That's the only way you get a return. Once you understand these principles, self-interest now truly becomes an exciting challenge, making sure everybody wins. Enlightened self-interest makes sure that everybody wins. Now, here's another one. If you want to find, you must seek. And if you seek, you will find. In order to find, you must search. You must go to church. You must go to the seminar. You must go to the library. You've got to go to the bookstore. You've got to go to the class. You've got to go to the training. You've got to go searching. Why? If you search, you will find. You'll find ideas. You'll find inspiration. You'll find hope. You'll find contacts. But you've got to be out there on the search, on the look. Life reserves its treasures for those who deserve it, not those who need it. Enlightened self-interest, giving so that you will receive, searching so that you will find, making sure that everybody wins all the way around. Enlightened self-interest needs to be educated. Enlightened self-interest says, I will learn that life is not just the passing of time. I will learn that life is the collection of experiences, ups and downs, highs and lows, laughter and tears. You must decide to act. You must have the discipline to act. Now, here's what's important about discipline. One discipline affects another discipline. All disciplines affect each other. In fact, here's a good philosophical phrase. Everything affects everything else. Nothing stands alone. Don't be naive and say, this doesn't matter. Of course, it matters. It all matters. Some things may matter more than others, but everything matters. If you'd rather sleep in than go for a walk around the neighborhood, pretty soon it will matter. If you'd rather spend your money instead of saving it, pretty soon it will matter. If you'd rather put off a letter to an old friend instead of corresponding regularly, pretty soon it will matter. If you'd rather work late every night instead of going home and spending time with your family, pretty soon it will matter. It all matters. Every lead domino affects the rest. If you won't walk around the block, you probably won't eat right, and you probably won't buy the books, and you probably won't attend the seminars, and you probably won't spend your money wisely. And after years of this, it all adds up. So the key to reversing this process is to start picking up the disciplines. It does matter. It all matters. Now, here's the positive side. Every new discipline affects the rest. Every new discipline makes a difference. That's why action is so important. The smallest action, the least action, the action that you won't think will matter, it all matters. Take it, because when you start accomplishing and the value starts to return, you'll find inspiration to do the next one and the next one and the next one. If you start walking around the block, it'll inspire you to start eating right. You start eating right, it'll inspire you to get a book. You get a book, and it'll inspire you to get a journal. You get a journal, and it'll inspire you to develop some skills. Disciplines affect each other. Lack affects the rest of your life. The key is to diminish the lack. One of our greatest temptations is to just ease up a bit, to do just a little bit less than you're capable of, to take a little break. Somebody says, it'll just affect my sales. No, it'll affect your consciousness, it'll affect your philosophies, it'll affect your home life, it'll affect everything. No, you can't ease up a bit. That's what vacations are for. When you're at work, work. When you're on vacation, rest. Wherever you are, be there. If you think about vacation when you're at work, you'll surely think about work when you're on vacation. You'll just mess it all up. So be disciplined, get involved, do all that it takes to get the job done. Get your health back, get your bank account where it's supposed to be, get your family in order. Get disciplined, be disciplined every day. When you set up the disciplines that give your life structure, miracles can happen, multiplied. And I'm telling you, anybody who wants to make a drastic change in their income can do it. I was broke at age 25 and a millionaire at age 31. Everything around was the same. I changed. I refined my philosophy. I read the books. I took the classes. I started looking at life a little differently. I'm telling you, it works. Now, there are 6 principles of building ambition that we will discuss as we go through this program. These principles work together, creating and directing energy, directing your energy toward achievement, directing your energy toward self-expression. Right now, we'll touch on the 6 principles in definition only, and later in the program, we'll get into each one separately. Here they are. The 6 principles of building ambition. 1. Positive self-direction. Knowing who you are and where you want to go. Accumulating the knowledge and being prepared for opportunities that come your way. 2. Self-reliance. Taking responsibility for your own life. Taking responsibility for whatever happens to you. Knowing that you have made the conscious decisions that are now affecting your life, counting on you. 3. Self-discipline. Ambition at the daily level. Knowing that you can reach your goals one step at a time, one day at a time, one activity at a time, and doing everything it takes to get there every day. 4. Self-enterprise. Consistently being able to create opportunity and consistently being able to take advantage of it, being aware enough to see it, skilled enough to make it work for you. 5. Working with others. We must make ourselves stronger to benefit us all. We must succeed at the service of others. Learning how to take your skills, enterprise, reliance, and direction to the table to create true success. 6. Self-appreciation. Appreciate your accomplishments. Appreciate your potential. Knowing that in one day you completed all you set out to do. Fueling your ambition by fueling your appreciation of yourself. Each of these principles, when activated correctly, helps develop your ambition, your eager desire to get more out of life, to gain wealth, to gain prosperity, to have a better family, to build a better business. All of these principles work together in creating and directing energy toward achievement and self-expression. Getting really good at something isn't about luck or doing it now and then, it's about what they call deliberate practice. This means practicing with a clear focus and intention to get better at something. Researchers noticed that successful folks had something in common. They concentrated on improving just one skill at a time. They didn't try to be great at everything. Instead, they carefully chose one skill that would help them the most at that point in their career. For instance, if someone worked in a big company, they'd look at what the top performers were doing really well. Then, they'd pick one skill, like a sniper aiming for a target, and make it their mission to master it. They'd make a plan and work on that skill every single day until they became really good at it. This deliberate and focused approach helped them move forward in their careers. How would they know if they've gotten really good at the skill they've been focusing on? Well, it's when others start noticing and telling them how good they're at it. They might hear things like, "Blimey, you're brilliant at negotiating," or, "You're spot on at getting appointments," or, "You're ace at closing sales." These compliments show they've mastered that skill. Once they hit this point, they can confidently say, I nailed this skill. Then, they start thinking about what skill will be most helpful for them to work on next. They do this every year, always focusing on improving one skill at a time. Loads of folks find themselves in this spot. Roughly 1.5% of the population sets off on their journey into the working world. It's like a massive marathon where everyone lines up at the starting line. Then, when the signal's given, like the bang of a gun, everyone starts running. Just like in a marathon, some people sprint ahead quickly. In this race, which is really about earning money, most folks end up somewhere in the middle. But sadly, there are also some who lag far behind, unable to keep up with the pace. So it's a bit like a big race where some zoom ahead, some stick to the middle, and some sadly fall behind. There was this really long study that went on for 25 years, and it's just been finished recently. I reckon it's one of the best studies ever done about how people become successful. They were curious about something. How come some folks earn such whopping paychecks? These folks are raking in nearly $1 million each month just by going to work. And if they ever lost their job, another company would snap them up quick and pay them a massive $10 million every year. That's a huge amount of money. So the researchers wanted to know, how does this happen? They wanted to figure out why some people are so successful in life. They reckoned maybe these successful folks were just super brainy or had some special talents or qualities that helped them achieve so much. So they decided to dig into the records from when these successful people were in school and their first couple of jobs. They wanted to see if there was anything special about them that stood out. And guess what the researchers discovered? These successful folks were actually just like everyone else when they first started out. They weren't any brainier or more talented than the average person. Even at the start of their careers, they were just average folk, nothing extraordinary about them. But then something interesting happened. They all started using one particular strategy. And let me tell you, this strategy has the power to transform your life and your career forever. And what's really surprising is that it's so simple, you might find it hard to believe. When these folks started their first job, they had a savvy approach. They'd head straight to their boss and have a chat. They'd say something like, hey boss, I really want to do well here and make a meaningful impact. What's one skill I could work on that would really help me succeed and contribute more effectively to the company? This simple question opened up a world of opportunities for them. When they asked their boss for advice, some managers would often suggest specific skills that could make them much more valuable in their job. These skills could be things like negotiation, teamwork, sales, or understanding financial statements. The boss would explain that being really good at one of these skills could set them apart from others. So they would listen carefully and take note of the skill the boss recommended. They treated it like a goal. Just like how you plan out your lessons for school subjects. For instance, if someone wanted to become a doctor or an engineer, they'd know the courses they needed to take to get there. Similarly, they create a plan for developing this skill. They figure out which books were the best to read and which audio programs were the most helpful. In today's fast-changing world, if you're not continuously learning and improving, you risk becoming outdated. This means that the job you currently hold may not be in demand for long. It could be as soon as a week, a month, or a year. Sometimes new technology can render an entire job type obsolete in just a couple of years. Therefore, it's crucial to keep pondering about what your next career move might be. Ask yourself regularly, what do you envision your next job could be? You're probably aware that most people who start working today will change jobs approximately 14 times and may even transition careers up to 6 times. They might find themselves working in as many as 6 different fields throughout their lifetime. So what do you foresee as your next job or career path? Here's a crucial point. What steps can you take right now to enhance your skills and capabilities, enabling you to earn enough money and live the life you desire? Unlock your next career opportunity by focusing on excelling in your current role. Aim to be the top performer in your current job, then aspire to become the best in your entire field. Once you attain the pinnacle, exert effort to maintain your position and enhance your life further. What actions must you take to achieve this? What kind of person do you need to become? If you could master one skill or a set of skills exceptionally well, which would have the most positive impact on your future? Your mission is to discover that. You might need to consult your boss or conduct some research to find the answer. Once you've identified it, dedicate yourself to learning and enhancing those skills to the fullest. It's all about recognizing what will bring the greatest positive change to your life and concentrating on mastering it continuously. Ask yourself, where do you envision your future in your career? Where do you perceive your career trajectory heading? And what about your industry? What direction is it taking? Likewise, what about your specific role at the company you're employed with? What are their prospects? By understanding where your future lies and foreseeing it, you can equip yourself to adapt and excel. If you don't learn to manage change adeptly, you'll find yourself swept away by it rather than taking charge of the situation. You'll feel at the mercy of whatever comes your way. It's akin to being tossed around by the waves of life. However, by becoming highly proficient at handling change, you can navigate life's fluctuations with much greater ease and confidence. Expertise helps you become the powerful variable, wanting to excel in all of the skills and settling for nothing less than an outstanding performance. If you're willing to be the best in your field, if you're willing to demand of yourself excellence and skills, to be the best that you can possibly be in the training, do the best you possibly can in doing a workshop. Do the best you possibly can developing the skills of using your personality, developing the skills of language, developing the skills of influence, developing the skills of organizing. If you're willing to be an expert in all of the skills, to invest those skills, and not only make a handsome living, not only make a lot of money, but if you would so desire, and if it would be your purpose a chance to make your fortune. You see, my friends, we're all given the same 168 hours in a week. It's what we do with those hours that truly matters. Now, if you're serious about climbing to the top of your field, about amassing wealth, and about crafting a life of unparalleled success, then listen closely. Dedicate just 10 hours of your precious week to self-improvement. That's it. Remarkably simple, yet profoundly effective. And let me tell you something. This strategy isn't just for the ordinary. It's the secret weapon of the elite achievers. I've had the privilege of rubbing shoulders with CEOs from some of the world's largest corporations. And do you know what sets them apart? They invest a mere 2 to 3 hours each week into reading and refining their craft. That's the difference, my friends, a small commitment to continuous improvement that yields monumental results. Do you know who holds the title of the 6th richest individual in the world? His name is Warren Buffett. Back in Warren's youth, at the tender ages of 14 and 15, he toiled as a newspaper delivery boy. Each morning, at the break of dawn, when the world was still cloaked in darkness and others slumbered, Warren was out there delivering newspapers. For over 2 years, he tirelessly delivered a staggering 200,000 newspapers, earning just a single cent for each. But here's where the tale takes a captivating turn. Instead of squandering his hard-earned money, Warren diligently saved it over time. His savings accumulated to $2,000. And do you know what he did next? That $2,000 became his inaugural investment. However, Warren didn't throw his funds into the unknown haphazardly. No, he meticulously examined his options and made astute investment decisions. And what do you think happened? His investment flourished, so he injected even more capital. The cycle continued. Fast forward to the present day, and Warren Buffett's total investments stand at a staggering $350 billion. Yes, you heard it right. He's the mastermind behind one of the largest corporations globally, ranking as the 3rd or 4th largest single company in the United States. Renowned investor Warren Buffett added nearly $1 billion to his net worth in 2023. Can you fathom the distance he's traversed from those early mornings spent delivering newspapers? It vividly illustrates the potency of shrewd investments and unwavering diligence. Now, $350 billion is an astronomical sum of money. It's an immense feat for a single individual to cultivate a company generating such colossal profits. But here's an intriguing aspect about Warren Buffett. He adheres to a remarkably consistent routine. Almost every day, approximately 80% of his time is devoted to absorbing knowledge pertaining to his business domain. Only around 20% of his time is allocated to meetings, phone calls, or other engagements. Why does he devote so much time to learning? Because he firmly believes that by perpetually acquiring new insights, he can make superior decisions and ultimately attain superior outcomes. Therefore, despite his towering success, he never ceases in his pursuit of self-improvement and deeper comprehension of his business realm. It's an inherently sagacious approach, wouldn't you agree? I frequently pose a question to adults. How much time do you devote each week to learning new things in order to enhance your productivity and value? Learning fresh skills can significantly improve both your professional performance and overall quality of life. Those who command higher salaries often perceive their earning potential akin to ascending a ladder. Envision a ladder with rungs. Each rung symbolizes a skill. As you acquire new skills, you elevate your capacity to earn more money. Moreover, with each additional skill acquired, your earning potential steadily ascends. Each new skill enhances your value, rendering you increasingly indispensable to others. Consequently, individuals are willing to remunerate you more generously for the outcomes you can deliver. Now, if at any given moment you decide to halt your ascent up the ladder of success, you might linger at the same level for a time, much like many people do, around 80% of them. However, as time elapses, you'll gradually descend because the skills you possess become less valuable at an accelerated pace. In today's rapidly changing world, skills are becoming outdated more swiftly than ever before. Therefore, if you're not continuously striving to improve, it's akin to regressing rather than progressing on the ladder of success. When individuals ponder why they're not achieving greater financial success, it's often because they're not enhancing their proficiency in their respective fields. They're not acquiring new knowledge or endeavoring to better themselves to attain greater success. Augmenting earning potential is precisely what the wealthiest individuals in the world do. They establish a routine of dedicating at least 10 hours per week to acquiring a new skill that can optimally benefit them. It's akin to perpetually ascending the ladder of success, with learning seamlessly integrated into their lives. Just as some individuals might allocate time to watching TV or engaging in sports, for them, learning is a constant. They possess a unique ability to concentrate entirely on one pursuit and persist until completion. Discipline yourself. Training yourself to maintain focus without succumbing to distraction like emails, phone calls, or background noise is paramount. It entails making a commitment to not allow anything else to divert your attention while you're engaged in important tasks. It's akin to honing a laser-like focus on a single objective and steadfastly warding off any interference. Napoleon Hill, renowned for his seminal work, Think and Grow Rich, later penned another influential book titled The Master Key to Riches. This book serves as a compendium of motivational ideas and principles aimed at guiding individuals toward success. After navigating through its 260 pages, you finally arrive at the conclusion where Hill unveils the grand secret, the master key to attaining wealth. In the opening paragraph, he hints at the wealth of motivational concepts and principles awaiting discovery within the book. And right at the climax, on the very last page of the final chapter, he reveals the ultimate revelation, self-discipline. According to Hill, possessing self-discipline is the quintessential key to unlocking wealth and achieving success. Society doesn't demand that you jog around the block every morning, but if you want good health, you must demand it of yourself. Society doesn't demand that you read a couple of books a week and improve your intelligence and your knowledge, but you must demand it of yourself. Society does not demand that you build a financial wall around your family. Nothing can get through. That's not a demand of society. But you must demand it if you wish it. You must demand it of yourself. Society doesn't demand that you learn a list of 10 skills in order to ensure your own future and the future of your family. Society doesn't demand it, doesn't require it. It is not a law. But if you want the benefit, you must demand it of yourself. Everybody will have the discipline to say, I will do the best job I can. I will make mistakes, of course, because we're all human, but I'll try to remedy those mistakes and do the best job I can. That kind of self-discipline that understands how important your part is in all of the functions that work, coming to work on the set here, to put on the broadcast, make it viable, make it real, make it powerful. Any couple of them missing, and it would be a disaster. But all of it put together, and it works like a charm. Each person, developing the self-discipline to do their part, do their job, the power of extraordinary performance. If you want to live extraordinarily, you must do extraordinary things. If you want an extraordinary income, you must do extraordinary things. If you want an extraordinary fortune, you must go with the demands of what it takes to have that fortune.